Have you ever encountered a system design that requires multiple clock sources with different frequencies? What if there was a single device that could generate all these clock sources for you simultaneously? Yes, this kind of product does exist. It is called a clock generator, and the topic of this introductory training session. For example, systems such as networking, factory automation, or medical imaging usually require disparate clock frequencies. As a result, multiple oscillators and/or crystals are mounted all over the circuit board, creating many potential points of failure. Having a clock generator not only can resolve your system problem, but also improve reliability and ease the BOM management because a clock generator can replace several discrete clock sources. After watching this video, hopefully you'll be able to pick the right clock generator for your design, as well as use it in the correct way. Although it sounds simple, the VCO frequency range is a key parameter of the clock generator because it determines whether we can generate all the system clocks together. The necessary VCO frequency can be figured out by doing a least common multiple of all the required clock frequencies. Unfortunately, there are cases that the resultant VCO frequency is too high to be realistic. For example, in the system shown here, the VCO of the clock generator will be at least 15 gigahertz. To overcome this problem, one could pick a clock generator that contains multiple PLL VCO. Each PLL VCO then will take care that all clocks have in the same frequency domain. Another way to overcome this problem is to select a clock generator with embedded fractional dividers. The resolution of the fractional divider will determine the frequency accuracy of the output clocks. In this example, the output frequency is -50 ppm, off from the target frequency of 24 megahertz. Apart from frequency accuracy, fractional dividers will also create additional spurs. In order to generate clean output clocks, the PLL loop filter bandwidth should be as wide as possible. Usually, the loop bandwidth will be higher than 100 kilohertz. In general, for a wide loop bandwidth filter, the phase detector frequency should also be high. Another benefit of having higher phase detector frequency, the end divider will be smaller, which has a nice result of reducing the PLL noise. To determine the maximum possible phase detector frequency, we can calculate the greatest common denominator between the reference clock and the VCO. In the example shown, with a 25 MHz input clock, great, the phase detector frequency could be as high as 25 MHz. However, if the input clock is 24 MHz, the highest possible phase detector frequency is 2 MHz only. Lower phase detector frequency may still be okay, but if not, you can select a clock generator with a fractional end PLL. One drawback from the fractional end PLL is the fractional engine may create additional spurs. With a careful design, you could be able to push the spurs to a higher offset frequency so that they will not disrupt the system performance. We cover these topics in more detail during some of our more advanced clock and timing precision labs. In order to reduce radiated emissions, some clock generators support SSC. SSC stands for spread spectrum clocking. It is a common technique for reducing EMI. Depending on the amount of spread, the fundamental frequency tone will be reduced by 6 dB or more. The modulation depth and profile are usually configurable, allowing the user to pick the right settings to fall underneath the system's spectral mask limits. A unique feature of clock generators is the integration of loop filter components. Loop filters are usually configurable in order to provide some flexibility. This particular loop filter example has been designed to maximize the loop bandwidth. The flexibility of a clock generator can be extremely convenient when changing frequencies can be a matter of just programming a few registers by SPI or I2C. Often you can find integrated, non-volatile memory such as EEPROM in a clock generator. EEPROM can come in handy for some application scenarios when there is no microcontroller or FPGA available to program and configure the clock generator prior to startup. One can also find clock generators that support PIN mode, where users can select one of several predefined configurations through PIN strapping. Newer clock generator devices typically will support various supply voltages and allow different supply voltages for different functional blocks. Industrial temperature grade clock generators are very popular as well. For harsh environment applications, TI has automotive-grade clock generators that operate up to 125 degrees C. So far, we haven't talked too much about jitter performance. Not every clock generator design will need TI's industry best-in-class jitter performance of less than 50 femtoseconds, although it is always nice to have design margin. Generally speaking, there are two types of clock generators in terms of jitter: general purpose and high performance. General purpose clock gens are easy to use, crystal and oscillator replacements with integrated EEPROM, LDO regulators, spread spectrum, etc. They're suitable for use in systems for generating CPU or memory clocks along with interface clocks for standards such as PCIe. High performance clock generators are usually built with high speed, low noise processes, so that they can achieve less than 300 femtosecond RMS jitter. These devices are suitable for high-performance systems requiring data rates of 10 gigabit per second, 25 gigabits, or even higher. For more details on the building blocks related to the clock generator, PLL, or loop filter design, I'd encourage you to explore more in the clock and timing series of TI Precision Labs. That concludes this Precision Labs training video. Thank you for watching. If you need more information on TI clocks and timing, or technical resources, please visit ti.com.